First of all, Nina, aapka dhanyavaad, thank you for organizing this, and thanks to everyone. Hareka aapka jo hai swagat hai is book discussion mein. Aur main ye kehna chahta hu ki mere liye ye pehla book discussion hai. Kashmir did not exist for me. Mere liye Kashmir ka existence nahi tha, right? Then it suddenly came into existence in 1998 when I got married into a Kashmiri family, right? So suddenly, from not knowing anything about Kashmir to I got to know many things about Kashmir. We would sit together, हम बैठेंगे और जिस तरह का talk आप धीरेन जी बता रहे थे उस तरह का talk जो है शुरू हो जाता. हमारा कश्मीरी में जो मेरे in-laws थे उनका घर था सात मंजिला. वो सात मंजिले में उन्होंने बताया कि उसको टेररिस्ट ने occupy कर लिया था. Lower floor जो था वो लोअर कोर्ट था, फिर हाई कोर्ट था, फिर जो टॉप फ्लोर था वो सुप्रीम कोर्ट था. तो एक आदमी जो था वो वहाँ से भागा हुआ आया था, उसने अपनी हिस्ट्री बताई हमारे घर में आके, हम सुन रहे थे सब ये. तो कश्मीर बिकेम रियल एंड अलाइव फॉर मी. द सेकंड थिंग इट बिकेम वाज व्हेन वी रियलाइज दैट देर आर कश्मीरी पंडित कैंप्स इन कश्मीर. आई डिडंट नो अबाउट इट एंड आई गॉट टू हियर इट. एंड वहाँ पे मुझे मेरी वाइफ जो है वो भी निधि है, हम दोनों को रिक्वेस्ट किया कि अगर आप वहाँ पे कश्मीरी पंडित कैंप्स में बच्चों को लोगों को बहुत से सिम्टम्स हैं तो आप अगर जाके वहाँ पे हेल्प कर सकें. तो ये हमारा पर्सनल था कि हमने जाके हेल्प करना शुरू किया, राइट. हमारे लिए उस वक्त जो है ये नहीं था कि वो कश्मीरी पंडित हैं, हमारे लिए था कि वो एक कैंप है, राइट. वहाँ हमको जाके काम करना, दैट्स द वे वी साइकोलॉजिस्ट आर ट्रेन्ड, राइट. डोंट सी रिलीजन, डोंट सी वेयर द पर्सन इज कमिंग फ्रॉम, सी द सिम्टम्स ओनली, एंड दैट्स वेयर यू नीड टू, यू नो, ह्यूमैनिटी इज द ओनली रिलीजन, वी हैव टू टेक एन ओथ फॉर दैट. वी स्टार्टेड वर्किंग देयर एंड one by one we started realizing that many stories would come up, people would start sharing their narratives, their stories, and suddenly we were shocked because I said ki ye to humne kabhi padha hi nahi iske bare mein, na koi media ne isko cover kiya hai, na iske bare mein likha gaya hai. To main apne jo hai diaries mein usko likhta tha roz aake, aur roz hi jo hai ek koi na koi jise kehte hain marmahat करने वाली स्टोरी होती थी. किसी ने कुछ खो दिया, आइदर देयर इज अ होमिसाइड. एक दिन मेरी वाइफ निधि वो वेमेन के साथ ग्रुप ले रही थी तो दे शेयर्ड की दैट सम ऑफ देम वर सेक्सुअली असॉल्टेड व्हेन दे वर कमिंग. एंड जब उन्होंने इसके बारे में वहाँ से पुलिस से बात करना चाहा तो वहाँ पे उन्होंने बोला आपके लिए तो पूरा इंडिया पड़ा है केस लॉन्च करने के लिए, यहाँ क्यों करने आने चाहते हैं, राइट. सो इंसिडेंट्स लाइक दिस एंड वी आस्क्ड देम कि आपने ये बताया क्यों नहीं, तो कहते हैं किसको बताएंगे, because the males over there, they are already feeling ashamed that they cannot protect the family, right. India is silent about Kashmir, koi uske bare mein baat nahi karna chahta. To ye jo hai ye humne apne andar daba ke rakha hai, right. Ek din hum wo kar rahe the group, to ek bachcho wo adolescents ka group tha, to teen Sikh ladke bhi the, bahuton ko nahi pata ki Kashmiri Pandit camps mein Sikhs bhi hain. Wo uthke jo hai achanak bhag liye. तो हमने कहा भाई कहाँ जा रहे हो, तुम्हारा भी वर्कशॉप आधा हुआ है पूरा नहीं हुआ. नहीं, हमने अपने ग्रैंडफादर से कहानी सुननी है. तो हमें वो लगा कि भाई ऐसी कौन सी कहानी है जो आप हमें छोड़ के ऐसे जा रहे हैं. तो एनीवे वी वेंट एंड आस्क्ड द ग्रैंडफादर कि आप कौन सी कहानी सुनाते हैं. तो कहते हैं कि मैं इनको जो है सिख जो गुरुज़ हैं खासतौर से तेग बहादुर हैं उनकी कहानी सुनाता हूँ. तो हमने कहा कि क्या हम भी बैठ के सुन सकते हैं. उन्होंने कहा हाँ हाँ क्यों नहीं. तो उन्होंने कहानी सुनाई कि कैसे जो है 300 साल पहले जो आप बता रहे थे जो सिख्स ने औरंगज़ेब के साथ एक वो किया था और तभी जो है हिंदू धर्म हमारा बच गया. मुझे उस वक्त एक बहुत अजीब सा लगा कि एक कश्मीरी पंडित कैंप में बैठ के कैसे थ्रू ओरल हिस्ट्री, थ्रू स्टोरी, थ्रू मेमोरी हम अपने आइडेंटिटी को प्रिजर्व कर रहे हैं. तो हमारी कहानियाँ ऐसे बढ़ रही थी. फिर एक दिन जो है हम कैंप से बाहर आ रहे थे, वी वर कमिंग आउट ऑफ द कैंप एंड दिस मैन केम अप एंड सेड व्हाई डू यू कम हियर. सो वी सेड वी आर साइकोलॉजिस्ट, वी वर्क विद द थिंग्स. सो ही सेड डू यू इवन नो द नेम ऑफ दिस कैंप. सो वी सेड या अमुठी. सो ही सेज नो, दैट्स नॉट द नेम वी हैव गिवन इट, दैट्स द नेम द गवर्नमेंट हैज गिवन इट. डू यू नो व्हाट इज द नेम ऑफ दिस कैंप. सो आई सेड नो. ही सेज दिस कैंप इज कॉल्ड औरंगज़ेब्स ड्रीम. So I was a psychologist and I had not read history not. Yes, I liked history. I liked reading psychohistory. Eric Erickson is one of my favorite teachers who has written about Gandhi's truth. I had read that. But nowhere I had imagined that a man coming out would challenge me about saying that this was Aurangzeb's dream, right? And Nidhi was there. He spoke to both of us in, you know, he spoke to her in Kashmiri. We came back, we opened our laptop, Googled Aurangzeb. And then we found that he was referring to a story of 300 years back where the Kashmiri, where somebody told Aurangzeb that if you convert Kashmir, the whole of India will be converted. And the Kashmiri Pandits got so scared that they went with a jatha to the ninth guru. He came to Delhi, sacrificed himself, and that is the Sikh records that they have, right? We went to Anandpur Sahib, you know, with our book when it was complete, and the Granthis, they told us that, yes, this is our history, right? What we call between oral history, memory, right? So memory studies and history are different issues, and I'll come to that shortly. That opened my eyes, and I said that, okay, a story 300 years back is carried by these people, which is a living reality for them, that even they have named the name of the camp after that. So that's the time I thought that I should start writing a book. Right? It came from within. I realized that I have written clinical reports, hundreds of them, but I could not find a way to write this in the form of a clinical record report, what I was hearing every day. So I sat down with the narratives, right? And suddenly characters started appearing, they started building. To be honest with you, I did not think that I can ever write a page of fiction, but words started to flow out. So I started writing, and I brought on the character of Aditya, who's the protagonist of this book. He is someone who, like Nina said, 300 years ago, ran away from Kashmir because his temples were destroyed. I mean, hum sabko pata hoga ki Kashmir mein 7 exoduses abhi tak hue hain, right? The last one in 1989 was the last exodus, the 7th exodus. Uske pehle there have been 7 exoduses where Kashmiri Pandits have run away to different parts of India and settled down. Ye unki history mein hai. So, Aditya was a character who ran away 300 years ago, settled down in Benares, and then ek aisa hota hai ki, you know, he goes back to his temple in Kashmir. When he goes back, he finds that there is a mosque built next to it. So there is a temple and a mosque side by side, right? And the character of the antagonist, Anwar, came to me in a flash one day. You know, I was reading about Kashmir, and there was report about stone throwers. And I have worked with stone throwers in Tihar jail. I have been in for there for 12 years. There was a gang called Patharbaz gang, you know. Tihar is known by different gangs, you know, this gang, that gang. There was a gang called Patharbaz gang who were expert stone throwers. And I said, okay, the antagonist is a stone thrower, the son of an imam. The protagonist is a Hindu, the son of a priest who has come back. If they were to live together side by side in a temple and a mosque, what would happen, right? I let my imagination run wild, which is an absolute sin for clinical psychologists. Stick to facts, stick to data, right? But as I let that thing, I realized that in my career, I have met both Hindus and Muslims, and the interaction from them, as I checked on the notes, things started flowing. I started writing, right? I was not a writer, my writer nahi tha. If I see my first draft and I see what finally came out, and that is after a lot of chiseling and hard editing, I was making mistakes all the time, right? I mean, someone was sitting on the left, in the next paragraph is sitting on the right, right? And my wife did a major job pointing it out that, look, you know, he was sitting on the left, right? How come he sits on the right in the next paragraph, right? So becoming a writer was not easy for me from being a psychologist. But I turned. I realized that we all have a writer inside us. Hamare sabke andar ek writer hota hai. So that's how this book came about. Aditya is the protagonist. Anwar is the antagonist. Anwar, jo hai, he wants to throw Aditya because he's indoctrinated by a person who is, people who have read it, they say that he resembles some very famous people. I would not like to name that from my own self. You read this book, you find out this is from my interactions with them in Tehar jail, right? And I have changed enough details so that, you know, identity is not disclosed and this is not changed. But almost all the interactions, all the things that I have done, they have a kernel of truth. They have come from my interaction with the people that I have worked with. So they are both indoctrinated and they both fight with each other. And in the process, what happens is that they discover that behind the indoctrination, behind what they have been told, there is a common humanity that they share. They discover that common humanity and they reject what has been told, talked to them. And in the process, they face ostracism, particularly Anwar, who becomes completely ostracized within the community for saying that, you know, he is right now someone who has deviated from the cause, right? So that's the way I wrote it. I tried to bring about the conflict between, which has existed between Hinduism and Islam over here, with Islam very often trying to going ahead and trying to exterminate Hinduism from Kashmir in different ways. I have talked about the destruction of temples over there in Kashmir and also all over India. Recently, Mr. K.K. Mohammed, who is who was responsible, jo uske unhone jo Ayodhya mein jo unhone dig kiya tha, he read this book. He took it and read it, and he says that as a Muslim, I can tell you that it's deeply healing for me, and it also absolves me in some way to know that my ancestors, my community has done something like this, right? So which was, that was the goal of my book, to bring healing and reconciliation, to make people aware. I'm very clear about one thing, that we cannot deny the past and get away from that. We cannot also undo the past, but we can understand the past. We can acknowledge the past, and I think that is how we go ahead forward, right? And this is something that the book has been described as hard-hitting, right? They have said that, you know, many of the things you change, right? I have not done that. One of the top publishers said that this is a very good piece of writing. We will change it, provided you make some major changes to make it balanced. So I said, I will not do that, right? I will not go into what balance meant for that. But one of the major aspects of that balance was that you make the heroine of, the woman character of the book originally a Hindu, right? So therefore, the thoughts that she has or the feelings that she has, the attractions she develops for the character can be justified. I said, I'm sorry, I do not subscribe to that kind of thinking, right? You can be original, belonging to whichever religion you are. There is something behind you, right? It is never the people who are the problem, as far as I see. It's ideology, right? And it's the way you interpret the ideology. The ideology was interpreted to for iconoclasm, for destruction of temples, for conversion. That is wrong. And that is what I have tried to bring about. And that is something I want to understand. I will not dilute that. So I had a lot of problems with publishers. Finally, a Kashmiri publisher who read that book, he took the courage and he said ki main isko publish karunga, chahe jo hai, ho jaye. So therefore, he took the step. He published the book. It is a long story about how I ran from publisher to publisher from them. All of them had one thing. It's a good book. It's a very good book. Lekin aap isko balance kijiye. Make it more balanced, right? And I said, what is balance, right? So I asked one of them, I said, suppose I were to write a Jewish book, does that mean that I write also about what Germans, you know, have also suffered? Why can't we just write about, one aspect of it itself, right? So why do we have to make it balanced? This is what, make it balanced is what actually governs the literary scene, the scene for, you know, writing in media right now. This, I believe, must go. We must be able to face what has happened, not to blame, not to go ahead and, you know, pinpoint someone, but to make people understand, make people acknowledge. That is where healing and reconciliation would take place, right? I'm associated with psychologists who were involved with Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa. We have talked about as to how reconciliation has come about. It's always come about by confronting the truth of the past in a hard-hitting way. That is not something you can run away from. Aaj ke zamane mein, abhi, I see a major change coming in our Indian society right now. There is a displacement happening. There is a structural displacement, जो बहुत बड़ा एक change, एक परिवर्तन जो आ रहा है. और जब ये परिवर्तन, ये displacement, ये structural change आता है, उसके साथ साथ historical memories जो हैं past की, वो ऊपर आने लगती हैं, जो आज हमारे देश में हो रहा है. So we need to understand those historical memories, not brush it away like we have done it for the 70 years. We need to understand that, have dialogues, have debates about it, and therefore is, I would suggest, is the way to go ahead. So this is a book in that direction. This is why I wrote this. It took me 4-5 years to write and 3 years to go ahead and, you know, push forward and say that, well, I hope someone accepts it, I hope someone accepts it, I hope someone accepts it. It's been read by eminent persons today. I mean, some time back, the person who was responsible for the breakdown of the Berlin Wall, Vamik Walkin, read the whole book. He was here on a trip. And he said, in all the visits that I have been to India, I never understood Hindu-Muslim relations as well as I did from reading this, and I'll take it, and he recommended. So book reviewers from across the world, some of them have read it and passed comments. And next week, I'm going on a trip to USA for a book tour. I'm traveling across USA talking about this book to everyone. So this is where I would like to end, and I would, with your permission, I mean, either we go on to question answers, or I read a small portion of the book, which you would like, either way. What would you suggest?
Read.
I read? Okay.
Once you read the portion, then we'll go on question answers.
Fine. There are many chapters over here, and I'm sure that each chapter is different in a way. So it's always a challenge for author to see what chapter he should read, but I'll pick up one which is one of my favorites. This is a chapter where the protagonist Aditya, he goes back and he finds that jo wahan pe Kashmiri pandits hain, none of them are helping him. This happens, you know, they want to brush aside the past, they don't want to get in touch with the past, and they say, you go away, right? But he doesn't give up, and he finds a mentor who tells him that hold back, never give up in the process, it's a long journey. He is a Muslim professor. I made it particularly Muslim because I felt that there are Muslims also who realize, some of them, that there has been historical wrongs done, right? And this was one of the reasons, this was one of the allurements I was given, that if I make him a Hindu professor, it will be accepted for publication by a major publisher. I decided not to, right? So there are some times that the author has to make hard choices, and this was one of them. This is one of the chapters, right? So this is, I'll read, it's a short chapter. Aditya knocked on the gates of the large three-story house. Is Pandit Gangadhar at home today? He asked. A young man came out. Oh, it's you again, Pandit Saab. We thought we could meet Pandit Gangadhar, said Aditya. Wait here, I'll check, the man said. He's so rude, Aditya thought to himself. If it weren't for my father's suggestion, I wouldn't be here. The young man came out and said, Father is sleeping, come another time. Saying this, he closed the door. The loud voices from inside had subsided. All lies, sleeping at this hour, Aditya's father said. All right, let's go back. When they reached the end of the road, Aditya recalled that he had forgotten his umbrella. When he returned to the gate, he saw two men outside, and the young man he had spoken to, he was saying, hope these two never come again. The men had wanted to go in, but realized it was too late. As Aditya started to leave, he heard one of them call him, Pandit Saab. In Kashmir, men are often called Pandit Saab. Pandit Saab, Pandit Saab, that's the way it's addressed. He was, I forgot my umbrella, Aditya said as he picked it up. We won't come again, he said. I'm Pandit Gangadhar, the elder man said. Maybe I should tell you why I asked my son to say that I was not at home and sleeping. It is not necessary. We won't come again. Aditya is a character who's very sensitive. He is the new Hindu who's arising. He's against casteism. He's against practices that have been prevalent. And he's also a very independent thinker. That's his character. But deep inside, he's a very sensitive man who is somewhere challenging, questioning everything the way Hinduism used to be. He epitomizes that character. Pandit Saab, we are the descendants of the family who accompanied Pandit Kriparam to meet Guru Tegh Bahadur. Your coming here brings back memories of a very tragic past for us. I think all of us are familiar with how the Pandits went to Tegh Bahadur. Do you know the story? No? Okay. What happened is that somebody told Aurangzeb that if you can convert Kashmir, the whole of India will convert. So he asked his general if the
why? You'll have to give them the details.
Yeah. Because it was, okay, sure. I mean, thank you for pointing it out because sometimes I assume that, you know, I go ahead, right? So, yes, when I started writing, I also went, why he did that? I did not know this. He said it because it was thought that since Kashmir is the center of Hinduism, right? आज भी पूरे भारतवर्ष में कहीं भी कोई पंडित अगर अपना जो है अपनी शिक्षा को पूरी करता है वो कश्मीर की तरफ देख के वो सात बार घूमता है he prays and then उसके बाद जो उसकी शिक्षा जो है उसकी एजुकेशन जो है वो पूरी होती है और ये माना जाता है कि वहाँ का जो पीठ है वो सब पीठों से जो है सबसे वो जो है सबसे वो बढ़ के है
वहाँ पे शारदा देवी का वास है शारदा देवी इज नोबडी आई मीन नो वन एल्स देन सरस्वती तो सरस्वती का वास मतलब कश्मीर में माना गया है
सो ये औरंगज़ेब को बताया गया किसी ने तो उसने इफ्तिकार खान जो उसके उस वक्त के वहाँ पे सेनापति थे जनरल थे ही इशूड अ फरमान सेइंग दैट कि कन्वर्ट ऑल ऑफ देम एंड दिस इज समथिंग डू इट एट वॉट एवर कॉस्ट बिकॉज ही वांटेड टू सी इंडिया कन्वर्टेड इन हिज लाइफ टाइम
या जनरली क्या होता है अगर आप द इब्राहिमिक रिलीजन्स वो जो फंक्शन करते हैं दैट उनका एक हेड होता है लाइक फॉर एग्जांपल फॉर क्रिश्चियंस दे हैव अ हेड स्टेट फॉर मुस्लिम्स दे हैव अ हेड स्टेट सो इट इज पॉसिबली दैट देयर अजम्पशन दैट द हिंदू हेड इज इन कश्मीर नॉट नोइंग हाउ द हिंदू इज
डिसेंट्रलाइज्ड या
और इसीलिए भी उनको अटैक किया गया था क्योंकि हिंदुइज्म में जितना जो ज्ञान है जो जितना भी है वो पंडितों के द्वारा स्प्रेड किया जाता है या जो भी हमें जितना भी पता है योग है जो भी है ईदर बाय वर्ण और बाय जाति दो हैं लेट्स रिमेंबर वर्ण एंड जाति सो दोनों ही वहाँ पे थे पंडित जो वर्ण से भी हैं और जाति से भी हैं और अगर आप इनको दबोचेंगे इनको मारेंगे जो सेंटर ऑफ लर्निंग है द लर्नड पीपल दोज हू नो दोज हू कैन आर्ग्यू विद यू दोज हू कैन से एनीथिंग इफ यू डिस्ट्रॉय द सीट ऑफ लर्निंग then everything will be destroyed.
Sure.
So this is perhaps their ideology and Saraswati ka vas to tha hi and this is why they focused on Kashmir as such.
Sure.
Because it works with their mentality. Mm-hmm. Not knowing how Hinduism is slightly different or vastly different in working.
So uske baad jo hai Aurangzeb ne usko ye order diya ki tum convert karo kaise bhi ho. तो जब कश्मीरी पंडित का 500 लोगों का एक जत्था उसके बाद गुरु तेग बहादुर के पास जो उस वक्त के नौवें गुरु थे उनसे मिलने के लिए गया और उनसे जो है बोला कि ऐसा ऐसा हुआ है तो आप हमें बचाइए तो उस वक्त जो 10वें गुरु थे गुरु गोविंद सिंह वो उनके साथ खड़े हुए थे उनकी उम्र 10 साल की थी तो व्हाट ही व्हाट when Guru Tegh Bahadur heard that, he said a great sacrifice may be necessary, because in those days it was believed that it was sacrifices that makes us achieve things. ये हमारे हिंदू धर्म में भी कॉन्सेप्ट है कि a sacrifice is necessary. So उन्होंने अपने वो फादर की तरफ देखा, पिता की तरफ देखा और बोला कि आपसे ज़्यादा बढ़कर ये sacrifice और कौन दे सकता है. तो वो फिर आए, उन्होंने औरंगज़ेब को चैलेंज किया कि अगर तुम मुझे कन्वर्ट कर सकते हो तो पूरा हिंदुस्तान, मैं तुमको कहता हूँ, कन्वर्ट हो जाएगा. राइट, ये पर्शियन रिकॉर्ड्स में नहीं है, ये सिख रिकॉर्ड्स में है. राइट, सिख स्कॉलर्स, सिख हिस्टोरियंस, दे डू दैट. जब मैं रिसर्च कर रहा था इसके बारे में तो ये मुझे पता चला, मैंने सिख स्कॉलर्स से, सिख उनसे बात किया. फिर औरंगज़ेब, फिर वो औरंगज़ेब के उसमें आए दरबार में, और उन्होंने, औरंगज़ेब ने उनको बोला कि अगर तुम अपना धर्म बदल लेते हो तो जो है तुम जो भी बोलोगे मैं तुम्हें वो करूँगा. लेकिन वो बोले कि नहीं, और उन्होंने उसको डांटा कि तुम ये क्यों कोशिश कर रहे हो. सो आफ्टर दैट ही वॉज किल्ड एंड हिज बॉडी वॉज यू नो टेकन सीक्रेटली. ये कहानी आप पढ़ सकते हैं. मुझे इस कहानी का, मैं नहीं जानता था. I got to know only after I started working in the Kashmiri Pandit camps. It's in the memory of people. People's memories, unki jo yaad hai, that has kept it alive. The Pandit community, the Sikh community, they have kept it alive. And as we say that, you know, history is written by victors. They never put that in the history, but it is something that, like that Sikh gentleman, that grandfather who was saying, he said he had heard it from his grandfather. His grandfather had heard it. So it has been going on. We have kept our history alive through memory simply because we are a persecuted race. Right, persecuted race don't write history, because writing history meant certain death, right, for societies across the world. If you write that this king ordered the destruction of this or killing of this, and you are discovered with that, you are killed. Right, this has been a fact. So anyway, coming back to it, yeah,
just one addition. You mentioned ki ye Aurangzeb ke, matlab Aurangzeb ke, what are they called,
so farmans
mein nahi hai. इसीलिए भी नहीं हो सकता है, बिकॉज दिस वॉज, वी मे कंसिडर दिस एज अ लॉस ऑफ द लॉस ऑफ आर्स, लाइक हमारे लोग मरे या हमारे गुरु मरे, बट उनके लिए भी ये लॉस था, क्योंकि उन्होंने उनको मार तो दिया, बट द होल ऑफ इंडिया डिड नॉट कन्वर्ट एंड ही कुड नॉट डू.
नोबडी कन्वर्टेड.
अपनी हार, जो विक्टर्स होते हैं वो अपनी हार भी, टेक्निकली औरंगज़ेब वॉज नॉट अ विक्टर बिकॉज ही फेल्ड, एंड आफ्टर दैट अ फ्यू जनरेशन, अब तो वो खत्म ही हो चुके हैं. तो वो इसीलिए भी हो सकता है, इसीलिए उसे एक्सक्लूड भी किया गया होगा. और जो विक्टिम होता है, विच आई ओनली लर्न फ्रॉम यू, वो ये मेमोरीज ज़्यादा रखते हैं कि उन्होंने किया.
दिस इज समथिंग विच आई रिसर्च, आई फाउंड दैट इट इज़ यूनिवर्सल. ये यूनिवर्सल है. मैं जूश साइकोलॉजिस्ट के साथ क्लोजली काम करता हूँ. आई वर्क विद साइकोलॉजिस्ट ऑल अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड. वन ऑफ द डिफिकल्टीज दे सेड दैट वॉज द एबसेंस ऑफ रिकॉर्ड्स इन ट्राइंग टू प्रूव दैट द होलोकास्ट हैपन्ड. देर इज नो रिकॉर्ड टू शो दैट हिटलर कॉज द होलोकास्ट. नो रिकॉर्ड, एब्सोल्युटली नन, देर इज नन. But the thing is, he was responsible, but how do you go back to him and say that, yes, this is the man who caused it? I mean, if you read that, you know, the Nuremberg trials, or if you, you know, read the works of Jewish psychologists at that time, they found no connection that, you know, so it was extremely difficult for them to prove as to culpability, कि किसने किया है ये. राइट, कल्पेबिलिटी हैज़ बीन अ मेजर इशू इन हिस्ट्री एंड मोर डिफिकल्ट इन इंडियन हिस्ट्री. राइट, सो देयरफॉर द डिफिकल्टी लाइज दैट हु इज़ द पर्सिक्यूटर, हु डिड दैट. राइट, अगर आज हम कश्मीर में जाएँ तो वी सी लॉट ऑफ टेम्पल्स डिस्ट्रॉयड. इज देर अ रिकॉर्ड ऑफ दैट हु डिस्ट्रॉयड इट? नो, बट दे आर ऑल लाइंग देयर डिस्ट्रॉयड. देर इज ऑल्सो, यू नो, देर ऑल, देर आर एवरीवेयर, देर इज़ नो रिकॉर्ड ऑफ इट कि किसने तोड़ा है. राइट, सो बिकॉज रिकॉर्ड्स वर नॉट केप्ट because of fear. It's important to know that societies, when they go, when they are in the survival mode, they do not record things. When they get out of it, they start recording, right? And that takes place around 25, 30 years, or maybe one generation, two generation passes. If you see the Jewish descendants of the Holocaust, they started writing after 25, 30 years. For the first 20, 25 years, there was no, record of what had happened. It was there, but accurate documented record. Probably that's why, you know, one of the biggest trials of the last century was when this British historian Irving, he brought it up saying that the Holocaust never happened, and the Jewish people had to fight, document for 5 years as to how Holocaust happened. They had to prove the existence of many things to say that so many people were killed, right? It's a very emotional topic for me. I have lived in it for the last 7 years. So I'll come to this, and I'll say that Aurangzeb could not convert him. He martyred himself, and that was the process by which I would say that you know, he made a major contribution to Indian history and studies, and it is something that binds us together. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So because it is people like your ancestor who did this. Yes. Today it is seen as an act that brought calamity upon Kashmir. If he hadn't gone to Guru Tegh Bahadur, there would have been perhaps very few Hindus left in India, said Aditya. Nobody sees it that way. But tell me, why did you come to our home? We have gone to the homes of many people for support to build the temple. And how do you find their behavior towards you? Very disappointing, Aditya blurted out. When we go to their homes, most of them have closed the door on our face. Some say that the ruin should be left as it is. The ruin here refers to the destroyed temple 300 years ago, around which the story is built. Why? Kashmiri Pandits live in perpetual fear in this land. Haven't you noticed? Your building the temple will only add to that fear. I want to qualify this. When we worked in Kashmir, when we were working in the camps, you know, one of the things that came up is that many Kashmiri Pandits said that if a Kashmiri Muslim was coming from the front, we would give our way to him. We still do that. Ye hamare jo hai na, wo behaviors mein wo ho gayi hai. I saw that myself personally, that you know how they would do that. I've written several blogs about it, those of you who are interested. This is purely from a psychological viewpoint, that how they felt oppressed and did that.
In fact, yeah. You talk about just viewing the way. In fact, you know, with the time, they adapted some of their cultures.
Sure, they did. Yeah. When Aditya came back, he told his mother, Ma, one more person asked us to go back today. Why don't you ask Professor Begg? Remember, he said his doors would always be open for you. 3 days later, without telling anyone, Aditya took a bus to the university. He asked a student about the professor, and the student looked at his priest's clothes. Do you have an appointment with him? The student asked. The student brought him to a room with Professor Begg written on the door. A number of people waited with notebooks in hand. Sir has a meeting with the department heads right now. Who do I say wants to meet him? Tell him it's Pandit Aditya Narayan. If he doesn't remember me, then tell him we met on the train and... The student cut him short. I doubt if he will meet you. He wrote his name on a chit and walked into the room. Aditya felt he had made a mistake in coming here. He was aware that the people were watching him with amusement because of his appearance. At least I tried. He didn't know when he dozed off. Aditya, he was shaken out of his slumber. What a surprise. The students around him stood in attention. It was the professor. Have you been waiting for long? I apologize, Aditya fumbled. I just walked in thinking you could spare some time. Of course I will. Let's go to my room. Tell the professors I'll speak to them later. After they sat down, he remarked, you seem very discouraged, Aditya. Most Kashmiri Pandits do not want me to rebuild the temple. They want me to leave. No, Aditya, you must build the temple. Large-scale violence affects the capacity of a society to remember and mourn for centuries. Today you are asking people to remember something for which their ancestors were killed. What if they don't want to remember the past? They will if you help them to create the space that heals. Why doesn't the past just die or fade away from memory? He asked. The past never dies, Aditya. It lives in the bosom of memory, protected like a child. I don't understand. The society 300 years ago had to suppress its story for its survival, and your ancestor isn't remembered as a martyr. Why didn't anybody do that with my ancestor? You have to remember that Kashmiri society at that time had no hope that their faith will survive. Who would think of creating a martyr in the midst of that? Hindus failed to create martyrdom where Islam or Christianity succeeded. Also, you're going back. raises some of the most traumatic events of Kashmiri history, the breaking of Hindu temples. When they were destroyed, the Hindus lost their sense of continuity. Everyone felt Hinduism would die, but it survived. Why are you saying all this to me? Because your task is to awaken your people. I should tell you the reason why I feel like I can't do it. I feel I'll be killed. Professor Beck covered his face with his hands and lowered his head. Aditya said, I only have one more question. Is the history of a people different from the memory they carry of their past? Professor Beck smiled. History, Aditya, dies 1,000 deaths, but not memory. Memory holds us together and gives us hope when wars, massacres, tear our continuity apart. It is our memory that keeps alive the sacrifice of our ancestors. You are a historian. Don't you find it a problem to trust memory over history? No. Their conflict is eternal. It is our memory that heals us, not history, from injustices of the past. History puts a blind on us, making us believe that we are prisoners. History is like an empress, angry with a whip in hand, who demands obedience to the written word. Memory is like the mother who holds us in embrace, protecting us when our soul needs answers. I thought holding on to the memory was painful. Sometimes it is not us who holds the memory. The air, the mountains, the land hold us to the story of the people. The pain comes when we resist learning the truth from memory. I was on the verge of giving up. Aditya walked out after taking leave of him. He looked at the sky. He felt as if his thoughts had scattered in a million pieces, leading to a warmth radiating inside him, telling him not to despair anymore. So that's where it ends. Yeah. This is one of the chapters which was my favorite. So, but there are many others, and it's an author finds it very difficult to pick up, you know, one chapter saying that that's his best.
We can start the question answer round now, but I have one pertinent question that I'd like to ask. Delhi is a city that has a lot of displaced Hindus, especially from Pakistan. Now we are discussing of displaced Hindus even here. In the paragraphs that you right now mentioned, you talk about the memory of trauma living in, whether we save the history or we don't save the history. So a lot of my friends here as well are, have come, are refugees. My own sister is married to a family that is not from India, in a family that is not from India. So my question is, what are the signs that the third generation or the fourth generation carries? What are the signs? What are the manifestations? Unke saath kya garbad ho rahi hai? Kya galat ho raha hai? Or maybe they are aware of it or maybe they are not aware of it, but by listening to our conversation and you giving insight to it, perhaps they'll become aware of it.
This is called transgenerational trauma. Transgenerational trauma is a new field, how trauma is passed on from generation to generation. I share with you a story. One of my close friends, they are a Jewish couple, psychologist, and once I was staying with them in USA, and we had to go somewhere together. Suddenly I noticed that before leaving, they start emptying their fridge. So I said, we are only going for 3 days, you don't need to empty the fridge. Oh, we do that every time. So I said, but I mean, this is rather, I don't understand why, but we have always done that. Then I said, okay, I mean, it's rude to be, asking question to your hosts like that. So then when we came out, I found them extremely sad. So I said, I hope I have not offended you in some way. So he says, no, all the Jewish families whose parents, whose grandparents, they died in the concentration camps, we find it difficult to store anything in our home. We find it difficult to store food. So I said, why? Oh, in the concentration camp, it was found that you store food, you are killed, right? That's it. One bread means one bread. If you're found with a second bread, even if it is stale, you are killed straight away. So that's why our families, it goes on, it's an unwritten thing. Even our children don't do that, they shared with me, right? Now, I asked them that, have you told your children not to do that? No, right? Transgenerational trauma, what we call about, you know, how trauma goes from one generation to another. There have been many ways it is transmitted. And I would not like to go ahead and talk of the symptoms here because, you know, some people might start self-defining, which I don't think it's okay. But one of the ways in which it is passed is through silence, right? It is passed through stories, right? For example, you know, when we were working in the Kashmiri Pandit camp, I remember one of the days when, you know, we stayed there for the night one day and the children said, tell us stories. So we said, what do you mean by telling you stories? I mean, we were tired at the end of the day, exhausted. And they said, nahi, kahaniya sunaiye. So anyway, I mean, both Nidhi and I were there. Nidhi called me, she said, stories are your forte, Rajat, you go ahead and tell. उनको हमने बहुत कोशिश की भाई आप सो जाओ कल सुबह स्कूल जाना है नहीं कहानियाँ सुननी हैं तो वी इन देयर पेरेंट्स ऑल्सो सेड कि वी हैवंट सीन दिस बिहेवियर इन देम यू नो दैट दे आर वांटिंग टू हियर स्टोरीज एनी वे वी टोल्ड देम स्टोरीज नेक्स्ट डे वी आस्क द पेरेंट्स कि आप कहानियाँ नहीं सुनाते बच्चों को नहीं जब से हम कैंप में आए हैं हमने स्टोरी सुनानी बंद कर दी है राइट बिकॉज दे We did the workshops, they felt probably healed in the process. They were again wanting to start their lives through storytelling, right? I mean, storytelling is cross-cultural, it is there universal. Why do we tell stories to our children? So that they can go through the night, so that they feel safe, right? We give them something to go through. That was completely disrupted and they said we had stopped it. But now, after that, I know that when we ask the parents that some of them, ab kyon nahi apne band kar diya hai, and that's when the mothers, some of them, they shared the story. Jab hum aa rahe the, to humko sexually wo hua tha hamare saath. We are traumatized ourselves. Kaun si kahani sunaye unko? Reality jo hai, sab kuch badal gayi hai, right? So we then went back and talked to the children. Then and they said, हाँ हमें मालूम है कि हमारे माँ के साथ हमारे इनके साथ गलत काम हुआ था इसलिए जो है इन्होंने लेकिन इसके बारे में हम बात नहीं करते हैं
And how does this silence affect the children?
It stops, it arrests, it slows down the development. It fragments you from inside in many ways, and fragmentation leads to a lot of symptoms, right? So I will not go into the symptoms right now because that is not something I would like to, but it is probably sufficient to know that this fragmentation stays deep, and every generation passes on this fragmentation till it comes to light. I was once interviewing a Sikh family, and the grandfather, I asked him about the family history. He said, "Hum partition family hain." मैंने कहा भाई पार्टीशन फैमिली है तो लेकिन मुझे केस हिस्ट्री लेनी है आपकी लिख लीजिए पार्टीशन फैमिली हैं तो आई सेड ओके ही डजंट वांट टू टॉक वन ईयर लेटर ही सेड आपने एक दिन वो सवाल पूछा था ना मेरे से कि पार्टीशन फैमिली मैंने बताया था मैंने जवाब नहीं दिया था क्या जवाब दें वहाँ से जब आए थे वी सॉ मर्डर्स इन फ्रंट ऑफ आवर होम वी सॉ आई कुड नॉट प्रोटेक्ट द वुमेन इन माई फैमिली क्या बताऊँ आपको वी डोंट टॉक अबाउट इट So we were silent, right? So ek saal baad unhone mujhe ye jo hai bataya, right? So we carry our memories in silence and Jewish psychologists, Native American psychologists and psychologists jo iske baare mein search kar rahe hain, they have gone through this and found out that there is something called transgenerational trauma. My book is about transgenerational trauma, right? So this is a field that is slowly coming about. And let me say this, that the goal in this is to find for healing. Awareness and understanding leads to a deep healing within. And that is something that we also need to try for our country. The historical memories that are coming up for Hindus need to be understood, right? Like you were telling me, Birla Temple, sorry I'm taking this time. But do we know that Birla Temple, there are no medieval temples in India? Birla Temple came up in 1939, right? For that, for 1,000 years before that, there are no temples in India, right? Why? Yeah, in Delhi, yeah. Why is it that? All destroyed. And the second thing is nobody built it up because the fear was so pervasive. The fear passed on. We started praying inside our home. Aap south mein jayenge, wahan celebration sab bahar hota hai. Lekin Kashmir mein jaiye aap, sab celebrations jo hai, pujas jo hai, sab hota hai, sab wo ghar ke andar hota hai. Abhi aap note karenge ki hamare celebrations fir se bahar hone jo hain shuru ho gaye hain. Hum apna collective, hamari identity jo hai, usko develop kar rahe hain, right? This is the healing process. Yes, right. So things have changed, are changing, and it is important to understand that from a psychological, social perspective, from that.
All the attacks were from the northern side. They came from Pakistan, Afghanistan and all. So this was the area which was the most vulnerable and that had to be protected. South, west and east was not attacked. So every time these people who were protecting the land had to protect their crops, their women, their kids. So temple was not the prime concern. That is one of the reasons that they said, okay, fine, let it be. We will pray inside and this can
happen. There was a survival mechanism and there was also a rule that was passed that the spire of a temple should not be seen beyond a certain distance. So no temple could be built that was of height, right? But Hinduon mein jaise hai, we have built magnificent temples. I mean, from the past, there are records of it. Agar aap Marthand Mandir mein jaye, wo jo Kashmir mein hai, jo aaj bilkul ek khandahar ban ke toota, wo khada hua hai. Agar aap south mein, to aap dekhenge ki ye jo shastra hai, jisko hum shilp shastra kehte hain, jo temples banata tha, it was highly developed. And yet it is, you know, something completely non-understandable ki Delhi, which was a major Hindu city, doesn't have any major temples. We have medieval mosques all dotting all around, right? We have the oldest church, which was St. James Church, and it is more than 250 years old. But the interesting thing is, why did we build it in 1939? Because of the spirit of nationalism that came up at that time. Right? Nationalism bought a speak and it gave the motivation to the population to go ahead and build a temple. And not only that, Birla temple was inaugurated by no less a person than Gandhiji. So this is something that puzzled me. Why did Gandhiji would come for inaugurating this temple? Because he understood the significance, but it was downplayed. It was not talked about because it would felt that it would create a difference or a fissure between the communities and it might affect the national movement, right? These are interesting parts of our history, very poignant, which we need to understand, right? Yeah.
Isme aapne kaha ki wo transgenerational jo trauma hai. So the people most affected with transgenerational trauma should be the Muslims themselves, because they converted because of those very things. You can say rape, forcible conversion, economic hardship, jizya dena hai to convert kar lo. To unme kya, unme kyon cheeze ye dekh hi ja rahe hain ya hum log samajh nahi pa rahe, number ek. Number two, ek personal question, are you a Bengali? To Bengalis bhi usko jhel ke aaye hain 40 years pehle, 50 years pehle. Abhi, there is a community called Rakhine Hindus. August 17 mein, 25 August ko, 1000 log mare gaye, Rohingya terrorist dwara. So that is, Yazidis ke saath bhi yehi hua. So how do you see this thing among those particular groups, Bengalis mein, West Punjab se jo aaye, ya Sindhis aaye, Kashmir mein aapne dekha, and Muslims themselves, जो कि सबसे बड़े भोक्ता हैं इस चीज के. हम लोग तो विक्टिम थे, हम लोगों को परेशान किया गया, हम लोग सब्जुगेट नहीं हुए, वो तो पूरी तरह से ले डाउन हो गए.
I do not consider Muslims suffering from transgenerational trauma. They converted. That was the end of it, right? They escaped. That was the escape route. The Hindu population that was killed or that was brutalized, like if I try to imagine that, let's take 300 years back when a temple was brought down, right? When the Hindus watched it, how it must have affected them. It would not affect the Muslims or those who were converted. No, I would not agree with that, right? So yeah, so I would not say that those who took the way out to find an easier path and, you know, go ahead, they would be suffering from transgenerational trauma, unlike those who did not succumb to it and kept on with that, right? Because there was constant pressure and force that was applied for them, and they knew that their, you know, parents, they have been either killed or massacred or changed. So that's a point of difference I would have over there, right? Transgenerational trauma is universal, right? For example, it's there, there with every persecuted society. And I think it's important for us right now to not compare, but to understand that, yes, we have gone through that, right? Because whenever I try to talk about the transgenerational trauma for Hindus, I'm often asked, but unke saath bhi to aisa hua hai, unke saath bhi to aisa hua hai. I say, yes, that's right. They have all talked about it, right? The Jews have talked about transgenerational trauma and are talking about it, right? When they do that, they don't compare themselves with anyone, right? They focus on only Jewish trauma. The Native Americans, my friends, who talk about that, only talk about Native American trauma, right? This is how the white settlers, this is how the white people killed us. This is how the white people destroyed us, right? I was speaking to a Native American psychologist some time back, and he was telling me that when this Dakota pipeline in USA, right, they gathered around it saying that this is our sacred spot, and they became extremely angry and saying that we will not let anything come up over here. The whole world's intellectuals went ahead and supported them, right? The same thing also happened in Babri Masjid, right? Hindus went there and said that this is our sacred space, right? But the entire world, including over here, we did not see the comparison. So why is it that you can support one and not support another, right? And when we get into that, we often lose sight of what we have gone through, right? So I prefer to focus on one thing. Of course, other societies have gone through trauma. Of course, other people have gone through trauma. Of course, Muslims may have gone through trauma, right? I have no doubts about that. I want to focus upon Hindu trauma right now, because otherwise we may dilute the focus. That is my humble request.
मेरा क्वेश्चन ये था कि उनमें ये चीज़ क्यों नहीं देखी जाती है अगर आपने कहा कि उनमें नहीं है यू डोंट सी द थिंग फॉर एग्जांपल इफ देयर इज अ लेडी हु इज रेप्ड दैट लेडी विल बी ट्रॉमेटाइज्ड इफ देयर इज अनदर लेडी हु इज रेप्ड एंड शी डजंट सकम टू इट वन बिकम्स एक का रेप हुआ और वो उसकी वॉट एवर फिर वो वैसे ही है शी एक्सेप्ट इट द अदर रेजिस्ट इट बट
I don't think any woman accepts it. I think I would.
तो वही चीज़ है.
I've worked with a lot of I've worked with thousands of women who have been through sexual assault.
I have not found a single one who accepts it. But your question is very relevant. I would like to answer this. We did a study on sexual assault in India. It's one of the major studies. It's gone publication. When we were comparing sexual assaults, we found that almost for all factors which are almost identical, the trauma faced by Dalit women was higher than that of the rest group, right? Which we felt very puzzled by. Why is it that Dalit women, you know, we checked the results again and again, ki hamare questionnaire, and then we found why it was higher. When a Dalit woman faces a sexual assault, the entire Dalit community goes up and they talk about how they have been traumatized from the past. Right, हमारा तो यही है हमें तो यहाँ से हमें हमारी तो history यही है the trauma gets exacerbated right but when someone who's a non-Dalit and I'm saying that you know when they get assaulted no such event we found was taking place right the entire women of the community do not go and sit and say कि हमारी हमारे साथ ऐसा ही होता है they share that so the trauma of the girl the trauma of the woman increases manifold right there are reasons for it right so this I disagree that any woman ever accepts rape or any woman accepts it no I don't think anyone accepts that
So, तो they changed and then they internalized whatever. आज उनमें वो चीज़ नहीं है. Hindus ने उस चीज़ को नहीं किया, but they are.
They withstood it. They suffered, right? And we still continue to do that.
वो एक allegory आप बोल रहे हैं या
example? नहीं, मैं समझता हूँ आपकी बात. So we withstood that. We suffered, right? Generation after generation who did not, right? Who did not succumb to it, they carried that trauma, right? And we are still carrying it. That is what I'm trying to say. Yeah.
point here. I personally feel, I mean, maybe some of people may not agree to that. I think entire Hindus around the world, they are suffering from the transgenerational effect. I mean, and that has a lot to do with the history which we have seen so far. I mean, you may say we have a lot of treasures in India, we were kings, we did this, we did that, but I don't think we have been able to control the external factors from that standpoint.
Just a small comment. I recently got a mail from a person from Malaysia. And if you read my posts, you will see that she has written it. It's there on the timeline. She said that when she read this book, it helped her to understand her back for the last five generations and what they have gone through. And she has started talking about it. And it has been a healing thing for us, right? I've had people from all over the world who have read this and who have, talked about that, how they feel their life history, you know, goes back many, many generations, right? A German psychologist read this book and she said it helped her to understand her past, even though her parents, her grandparents, they have a Nazi past. She said it helped me to understand my background, my roots, what I have faced.
Mere teen sawal hain. Jaise Rajasthan hua, ya Punjab hua, ya Bihar hua, ya hamare Uttar Pradesh mein jo Pasi jo hote hain na, वो उनके तो रेजिस्टेंस के हमको ओरल हिस्ट्री भी मिलती है, जैसे सोहेल देव पासी या राजस्थान में तो राणा प्रताप और ये सब जाटों का हमको मिलता है और उड़ीसा में मिलता है हमको. व्हाई डू वी नॉट हियर अबाउट द रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ द काश्मीरी हिंदूज? एंड हियर आई एम यूजिंग द वर्ड काश्मीरी हिंदूज एंड नॉट काश्मीरी पंडित्स, एंड आई एम पजल्ड व्हाई वी कीप ऑन यूजिंग द टर्म काश्मीरी पंडित्स नॉट काश्मीरी हिंदूज. सो नंबर वन, सो आई वुड लाइक टू अंडरस्टैंड. एंड सेकेंडली, आप लोगों से मैं ये पूछना चाहता हूँ कि अब 370 हट गया है, तो व्हाट आर योर एक्सपेक्टेशंस कि 370 हटने के बाद और क्या होना चाहिए कि कश्मीरी पंडित या कश्मीरी हिंदू वापस जाकर रहें?
बाय रेजिस्टेंस, इट्स नॉट ऑलवेज फाइटिंग बैक. रेजिस्टेंस कैन ऑल्सो बी थ्रू साइलेंस, राइट? एंड परहैप्स वी डोंट, आई मीन we don't know as much, but what I can say from understanding Kashmiri history and history of other parts is that sometimes people give in, but they do resistance in silence, right? Okay, now he gave an example about sexual assault, right? Many women resist silently while undergoing a sexual assault, right? For example, they refuse to comply with the persecutor, they refuse to go ahead with that, they are resisting. They may not be fighting with you, right? But they are resisting internally. They are not giving in. They are trying to show disobedience to what the persecutor is saying, right? This depends upon the internal states of the person, of the society at that time, how they feel that they can fight best, right? If they have fought, lost, and they have to think of survival, they may not be able to fight in a military manner, and we might mistake it as that, you know, they were not resisting, but they were, right? Kashmiri Pandits, they resisted. They did not give in to the conversion, right? Many did, but many also did not. And they are sure that even if they are killed now, they told me that if they get killed, even then they would not leave their religion. They would not do that, right? That is how I believe that Hinduism survived here, and we are still 85% Hindus. We showed what is called passive resistance, right? Resistance done in silence, resistance done through disobedience, through not following. This is also a very powerful form of resistance. All resistance is not military. That's what I believe. Yeah.
कारण मुझे जो लगता है कश्मीर घाटी जो है अपने आप में जो उसका डेमोग्राफिक पैटर्न था शुरू से ही, दे वेयर वेरी फ्यू क्षत्रियस, अधिकांश पॉपुलेशन पूरी की पूरी ब्राह्मण थी. अधिकांश आज भी वहाँ के मुसलमानों के जितने, चाहे बुरहान वानी हो, वानी इज ऑल्सो ब्राह्मण सरनेम, वो जितने उनके वो एक से एक आते हैं, ऑल ऑफ देम हैव ब्राह्मण सरनेम्स, जो उनको सिक्योरिटी फोर्सेस जो मार भी रहे हैं. तो वहाँ क्षत्रिय जाति बहुत कम, ओबीसीज जो कि क्षत्रिय से आए वो भी नहीं, शेड्यूल कास्ट थे ही नहीं. तो आई थिंक जो मिलिट्री विंग था हिंदुओं का वो वहाँ एब्सेंट था. इट वॉज ओनली एजुकेशन इज आज भी इंटेलेक्चुअल मतलब क्या बोला जाए, जो क्षत्रिय लोग थे वो लोग जम्मू में थे, डोगरा, पुंछ, रियासी, किश्तवाड़, डोडा। तो जब हम लोग तबाकत नसीरी पढ़ते हैं तो उसमें वो मेंशन करते हैं कहाँ एक एक गांव में कैसे कैसे युद्ध हो रहे हैं, एक ने उधर से मारा उधर, दिस समहाउ मैनेज इन द हिली ट्रैक्स। लेकिन जो घाटी है, प्लेन एरिया अधिकांश जगह जो है इंटेलेक्चुअल पना ज़्यादा होता है, क्षत्रियपना क्षत्रियत्व कम हो जाता है। तो छात्र धर्म की कमी थी, तो प्रोबेबली एक बार राज गया तो युद्ध करना वाला हिस्सा छूट गया, फिर अधिकांश कई तो कन्वर्ट हो ही गए वॉट एवर। तो प्रोबेबली दैट इज़ द रीज़न कि वो जो फॉर्मल ब्लड रेजिस्टेंस था वो ख़त्म हो गया। इंटेलेक्चुअली दे ट्राई टू रेजिस्ट वॉट एवर दे कुड क्लच ऑन।
क्या ये सच है, मैंने बस ये पढ़ा है, क्या ये सच है कि 300-400 साल पहले तक, और आप प्लीज़ जवाब दीजिएगा, कश्मीरी ब्राह्मण कश्मीर घाटी में भारत से जो बाहर के जो ब्राह्मण आते थे उनको रोकते थे अपना ज्ञानार्जन या अपना धनोपार्जन करने से? क्या आपने ये सुना है?
रोकते थे।
हम ब्राह्मण नहीं कहते हैं, हम अपने आप को पंडित कहते हैं, क्योंकि हमारा कॉन्सेप्ट ये था, जैसे आप बताएं कश्मीर वॉज द सीट ऑफ टीचिंग हिंदुइज्म, तो हम जो भी कश्मीर में आता था वो ही वॉज वन हु वॉज सीकिंग नॉलेज, सो जो भी नॉलेज सीख करने आ रहा है वो हमारे शास्त्र के हिसाब से ब्राह्मण हो जाता है। तो और पंडित इसलिए था क्योंकि पंडित को एक्चुअली हम ब्राह्मण से एक दर्जा ऊपर मानते हैं, क्योंकि जिसने सीख लिया समझ लिया और जो सिखा सकता है वो पंडित है। तो इसलिए वी आर ऑल कश्मीरी पंडित्स, क्योंकि हम ये मानते हैं कि हमारी जनरेशन उन लोगों से आ रही है जो हु केम देयर सीकिंग नॉलेज एंड हु अटेंड नॉलेज, सो इसलिए वी आर पंडित्स। तो ब्राह्मण तो खाली वो एक ऐड हो जाता है। इनफैक्ट जो हिस्ट्री मैंने सुनी है अपने फैमिली में, जो मुझे पता है वो ये है कि हम सारे ही जो लोग आज कश्मीरी पंडित कहलाते हैं उसमें से बहुत लोग ऐसे भी थे जो बाहर से आए थे लेकिन वो वहीं सेटल हो गए और कश्मीरी पंडित बन गए। और साथ में एक भी कि जब ये मुस्लिम इन्वेजन शुरू हुए थे, क्योंकि हमारे ये कुछ टाइम पहले किसी से बात हुई थी एंड यू नो वो उसके ऊपर बात हो रही थी कि हमारे हिंदू में इतने सारे कास्ट हैं, ये है, अब ये कश्मीरी हमेशा कश्मीरी पंडित ही क्यों होते हैं? मैंने कहा क्योंकि हमारा और कोई कास्ट ही नहीं है, हम सिर्फ कश्मीरी पंडित है। तो वो ही वॉज कम्प्लीटली शॉक, ही सेड ऐसा कैसे हो सकता है पूरे इंडिया में जब कास्ट है? तो मैंने कहा इंडिया में है पर कश्मीर में नहीं है, क्योंकि कश्मीर में वही लोग होते थे जो पढ़ने जाते थे, वही वहाँ सेटल हुए, जो बाहर से आए जो वो कश्मीर जो पंडित या ब्राह्मण नहीं भी थे, जब मुस्लिम इन्वेजन शुरू हुए तो देवर ऑल डिक्लेयर्ड एज कश्मीरी पंडित टू सेव द नॉलेज, टू सेव यू नो पीपल हु वर देयर, सो दैट इज हाउ वी हैव नो अदर कास्ट, वी आर ऑल कश्मीरी पंडित। सो यू नो जब लोगों को वो होता है कि ये तो ब्राह्मण है यू नो ये है, तो वी आर एक्चुअली वी कंसिडर आर सेल्व अबव दैट in terms of you know technically you can say, but it's not that we are above that, but technically that's what is understood. So hum wahan pe it's not hamare aur koi caste isliye hai hi nahi kyunki wahan everybody was there to seek knowledge,
exclusive apne aap ko rakhne ka. Kashmir ghati jo hai homogeneous as a pandit area tha, wo usko reach karne mein tum kahin se bhi ghus nahi sakte ho. There are just two or three, ek hai kishan ganga ka area, एक है झेलम के घाटी के, सो यू कैनॉट एंटर कश्मीर घाटी लाइक दैट. वो तो आज भी जो ये कश्मीर जम्मू रोड है, इट इज़ एन आर्टिफिशियल रोड, वो जियोग्राफिकल रोड नहीं है. ट्रेडिशनली झेलम से या कृष्ण गंगा से लोग घुसते थे. कश्मीरी जो रूलर्स थे दो ए न्यू दिस थिंग, टू प्रिजर्व देयर एक्सक्लूजनिज्म उन लोगों ने वहाँ चेक पॉइंट्स लगा रखी थी, नो बडी कुड एंटर देयर. People used to get killed and this is on record, various historical records mein hai. Koi ghusta tha uski thorough checking hoti thi whether it is from mainland Banaras hi kyun na aa raha ho. They would not allow anyone, wo nahi ghusne denge, they were very staunch in that thing. To probably wo jo inter mingling ya inter jo hona chahiye wo us level tak nahi tha. Probably एक ये कारण रहा होगा कि वो
रेस्ट ऑफ इंडिया डिड नॉट नो व्हाट वाज हैपनिंग इन कश्मीर फॉर अ गुड मेनी नंबर ऑफ इयर्स. कम्युनिकेशन चैनल्स नहीं, कम्युनिकेशन चैनल्स नहीं रहेंगे तो आज भी नहीं होता है।
इफ I think Kashmir, because of its mountainous nature, was an isolated place anyway. But that was also the reason why Hinduism developed to such an extent, because it was a very meditative kind of environment, which it still is. Aaj bhi agar aap Kashmir mein jayenge, to you feel that meditative environment all around, right? And Kashmiris, as I know from there, is that they were because they faced so many invasions, they were very protective about their knowledge. They didn't want that knowledge to be stolen, and there were many efforts at doing that. So therefore, like when you develop a lot of knowledge, you're also very careful about preserving it. So they're very protective about it even today, right? They're extremely fiercely protective about what they developed. It is same like Tibetans. They're fiercely protective about their knowledge, right? Whenever a civilization has gone up very high and they have faced threats, they become protective, right? This also, I believe, happened with Kashmir.
I think, first of all, though it has been answered precisely, very aptly by you, Kashmiri Pandits, by this, if you just do the research on the race, one, intellectually, that's what has been their main bread and butter. They have lived out of their intellectualism. That has been their main, livelihood, if you may say, and they were protective about that. So that's one. The second is, this has been Kashmir has been the fountainhead towards the invaders. Delhi was the central point. Of course, Delhi would never see temples because for every Mughal emperor, Delhi was the main head. Why would you expect a temple in Delhi? And you just saw a Birla temple 1930, whatever. Yeah. So precisely there was, this is never a martial race. This could never resist. And the population of that race started dwindling.
But you had Lalita Ditya, who was a fearsome emperor in the 8th century. What happened from the 8th century until the...
I think that's what I'm saying. So the external factors were pretty higher. They could not control it. Today also, if you see the invasions from the rest of the part of the border, the Mughals, that was the biggest thing.
No, he was a Kshatriya.
And per se, Kashmiri Pandit, by race, by blood, by nature, by behavior, it's not a Kshatri race. The Kashmiri Pandits were considered to be teachers of the top-notch race of Brahmins in South India, which is Iyengars. So, that's how it is.
The two things that I would like to point out is, this is more of a musing, what I'm thinking. Kashmir has also been the seat for Mahayana sect of Buddhism. So when we are talking about Hinduism, so there was Buddhism also, which got, experimented there, and it got exported from there. And when we are talking about whether we had Kshatriyas in Hinduism, and we are saying that only the Marathas were the Kshatriyas, amongst us, there were tribals living around Delhi who would get hired by the kings, before battles. So there were villages which were exclusively martial. When a fight was not going on, they would be looting and plundering. But that was exactly what they would do. They were by nature, they were fighters. So these are the two things that I was just thinking about.
Sir, I would like to, just give you a little information. We're talking about this aspect of, why did maybe the Kashmiri Pandit not resist, right? And so as you very rightly brought out, as a race, you Kashmir being a seat of learning, you all it's like the garam dal and the naram dal. Naram dal tha. Why things are happening, maybe why a change is happening, is because there has been passive aggression. Finally, there is a change which is happening. As far as the armed forces are concerned, we've got a very unique concept in our country. The army of India, the Indian army, it draws men from all states. So we have something called the infantry, in which we have got a regiment called the Jammu and Kashmir Rifles. Yeah. We have got another regiment called the Jammu and Kashmir Light Infantry, it's got a very, very mixed input. But yes, I mean, the Kashmiris are definitely much lesser. But the major intake is Dogra troops, right? Dogra troops. Then the Jammu and Kashmir light infantry has actually got a, they are predominantly Muslims. What I'm trying to bring out is, even in today's day and age, it is not that. I mean, Kshatriya hain, ladne wale hain. But yes, Kashmiris are definitely much lesser. And I guess demography wise, another issue has been, see, you cannot, especially when your own homeland, your particular area which you belong to is being threatened, it becomes very difficult if you are in minority to actually represent, because you will be the first people who will be taken down. And that is why the armed forces has a very interesting philosophy, wherein especially the officer cadre jo hote hain, they are never posted into the same regiments. If I belong to the land of Kumau, I will be preferred, I maybe go into a Jammu and Kashmir Rifles battalion. If he's a Dogra, it will be preferred he goes into a Kumau regiment battalion. So there are two reasons for that. One reason is it makes sure that you never have any kind of parochialism. There should not be any conflict of interest, exactly. And because the armed forces are supposed to work in a particular way. Yeah. Okay, there are various reasons why that is done. What I'm essentially trying to bring out is that as far as the fighting troops from Jammu and Kashmir are concerned, there's an illustrious history. As a matter of fact, they have done very well during Kargil also.
एक रानी थी एंड दिस वॉज अराउंड 1350 के लगभग. रानी की शादी हुई एक लद्दाखी बौद्ध से, बाल्टिस्तानी बौद्ध से. लोकल लोगों ने उसको रिजेक्ट कर दिया. उसने कहा मैं हिंदू धर्म अपनाना चाहता हूँ. तो लोकल लोगों ने रिजेक्ट कर, जो मिनिस्टर्स थे उसी समय, एक ईरानी, एक ये मर्सेनरी टाइप का आया, उसके प्रभाव में आके ये लद्दाखी बाल्टिस्तानी बौद्ध जो था, इंस्टेड ऑफ बिकमिंग हिंदू, देन वो गुस्सा होके मुसलमान बन गए. इट वाज लाइक काला पहाड़ ऑफ दैट. देन द होल थिंग चेंजेस. एक उस मूर्खता के कारण, और वो एक छोटा सा क्षत्रिय क्लैन था, अब उसका हेड जो है मुसलमान बन गया, तो बस हो गया पूरा का. तो वॉट वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट इज दैट पीरियड. वहाँ क्षत्रिय लोगों की बेहद कमी थी. नियरली एवरीवन वाज अ पंडित या ब्राह्मण, जो आपको कहे.
ऑल्सो वॉट आई फाउंड रीडिंग कश्मीरी हिस्ट्री वॉज दैट कश्मीरी हिस्ट्री इट्स एज इफ दे वर टर्निंग मोर एंड मोर इनवर्ड्स, नॉट आउटवर्ड्स, बिकॉज ऑफ द इन्वेशंस, बिकॉज ऑफ द अटैक्स, एंड दे डिड नॉट नो हाउ टू प्रोटेक्ट देमसेल्व्स. That they turn more and more inwards, and today I see them turning outwards, you know, which is a very good sign which I see of the present times. I mean, Kashmiri Pandit jab bahar aaye hain, so they are turning more outwards. In fact, Dalai Lama jo the, unka ek kuch din pehle main unka interview dekh raha tha. It is not something we agree with, but what he said is very important. कि ये जो Tibetans के साथ हुआ है, इससे जो Tibetans बाहर आए हैं, we had turned too much inwards and we are turning outwards.
Exactly my point. Geography plays such a huge role.
Sure.
कश्मीर is like a एकदम protected जगह है. वहाँ कोई घुस ही नहीं सकता है. Even probably उस समय के हिंदुओं ने सोचा कर लो क्या करेंगे. आखिर इस्लाम नहीं आ पाया ना, घुस नहीं पा रहे थे. दिल्ली में तो 1192 में आ गया. वहाँ 1350 में भी नहीं आ पाया, और वो भी आया डिसीट से, आया युद्ध से नहीं आया. यही चीज़ तिब्बती लोग कर रहे थे. चीन हम तो क्या है, रूफ ऑफ द वर्ल्ड है, कौन घुस लेगा. भूटान अभी तक करता रहा है. तो ज्योग्राफी प्लेस सोचते हैं हम एक्सकॉन्स हैं, एकदम मस्त रहेंगे, खुश रहेंगे, दुनिया हमारा बिगड़, लेकिन टाइम किसी को नहीं
छोड़ेगा. Psychological pressures which come on people when they start moving. I would rather like to introduce the word called migrations, which has impacted so many civilizations around the world. I studied there. जो आप कह रहे हो जो प्रेशर बिल्ट अप होता है यू नो आई गिव यू माय पर्सनल एक्सपीरियंस इन स्कूल हाउ डज इट स्टार्ट प्रेशराइजिंग बट यू कीप डाउन योर हेड एंड यू कंटिन्यू विद इट वहाँ पे हम स्कूल में यू आर इफ यू आर ए हेड बॉय एंड आई केम फ्रॉम मिशनरी स्कूल देयर वाज वन ऑफ द बेस्ट स्कूल्स देयर 200 ईयर ओल्ड स्टिल यू वुड फेयर दैट द मुस्लिम बॉय वुड ओबे टू यू बिकॉज यू बिलोंग टू अ पर्टिकुलर कम्युनिटी And we were taught at home not to speak back. But I'll cut the whole story short. But now, when the migrations are happening, you said about Dalai Lama, you know, come out and you shine. So the Kashmiri Pandits are shining outside. Why? Because they are in different environment. Now, when I say environment, it's not about geography. It's about weather. It's about, talking to, for example, I became part of this discussion today, with best of the best people, best minds. We learn more. So adaptation to that. Where would I do this discussion there? It was complete Islamic discussion. Right? So people are changing from migration, but the pressures which we had that our children do not have. They are changing, they are becoming fast. And by the way, to answer your question, they are changing professions. They are daring to change professions. They are wanting to take up, to start, he becomes an entrepreneur. Why? Because he would have lunch with an Agarwal boy of Delhi. What would he learn from them? Yeah. Oh, Agarwal boy, okay, he has a different mind. Because he knows 2 into 2 is 5, not 4, he would multiply that.
Sure.
So it changes completely. And now from, if I see ancestors, we have not done business, we have done our basic education, taken jobs, kept our head down and moved on.
Right.
That's not something which we did. But yeah. This is a great learning. Business guy would not get married.
When you say that it's been a very good thing, I mean, one of the reasons has been seen that why this extraordinary achievement by Jews, and it has been found that they are, because of the so many displacements that they had, where they were thrown out, they are always on the edge of society. And when you are on the edge of society, your way of looking at things is very different from when you are in the center. So that's why you become creative. The creative people are always on the edge, and Jews have been on the edge of every society, and that's why they could become so much creative. Creativity studies have shown that, and that is what I also believe, that the extraordinary achievements by Kashmiri Pandits or Tibetans has been because today they are getting on the edge and they're developing their creativity. What you're saying.
I have one simple question. There are so many things about Muslims coming and settling down in Kashmir. How long have been the original Kashmiris settled in that area of Kashmir, and was that a totally Hindu state?
Yeah. We were a completely Hindu society.
Yeah. How many years?
Kashyap Rishi, the oldest. The name Kashmir comes from Kashyap Rishi. He was the one who established Kashmir, and we are supposed to be the descendants of that age. So it's been there since till the time the invasion started.
आज अगर आप अभी कुछ महीने पहले हम कश्मीर में थे तो हमने नोट किया कि वहाँ के जो सारे नाम हैं वो बदले जा रहे हैं very surreptitiously, very things, and because these are such historical names. हम जब वहाँ पे मंदिरों में जाना चाहते थे तो हमें ड्राइवर्स कहते थे कि यहाँ अब मंदिर है ही नहीं या अगर हाँ मतलब वो मंदिर जो हम हरि पर्वत के वहाँ पे मंदिर में जाना चाहते थे तो ड्राइवर हमारे से आर्गू करने लग गया वो मंदिर तो है ही नहीं जी कोई मंदिर वहाँ पे नहीं है फिर जो
हरि पर्वत क्या है जी
Yes, sure.
That is the figure which
and my book is based upon that.
This is what is called, changing the narrative.
Yeah, very true. So my book is based upon destroying one such temple which Aditya built up and it was destroyed again in 89. And the fact is that he still does not give up. He continues, shows the eternal resilience that Hindus need to find in themselves, which they have. That is the message of the story.
Is passive resistance, is this advisable and or if and what amount of resistance should be aggressive, openly aggressive, and how much should be passive? where are the how do we draw the limits? Where do we draw the lines? Yes.
It's a very good question. I think it is very important not to be judgmental about resistance, right? I don't know what state of mind you were in to say that you should have done this, right? There are times when you need to fight militarily. There are times you need to people show passive resistance. I have met that in victims all throughout my life, right? And I've stopped being judgmental. Because that point of time, what you felt, how you went through, it may not have been possible for you to fight militarily, right? I share with you a very poignant story. I mean, it is about, you mentioned about sexual assault. There was this perpetrator who assaulted a woman, right? And I said, you gave in? No. She said, I did not give in. How did you resist? I refused to obey his commands. He asked me to take off my clothes. I refused. I did it so slowly. That was the only way I could resist, right? So people resist in different ways, right? Fear traumatizes us. Fear inhibits us from working. It can be very easy for me to be in a normal state of mind and say that you should have done that. But if I was in that frame of mind facing an adversary, if I was facing the survival of my family, if I had to care, right, I may have been in a very different state of mind. So one cardinal rule we have is that let's never judge victims.
Passive resistance is temporary. जब स्ट्रेंथ है तो आपको एक्टिवली रेजिस्ट करना ही होगा. दोवाल साहब का कितना वो एक वो है, ही वॉज़ इन लाहौर एज एन अंडरकवर एजेंट, ही वॉज़ ड्रेस्ड अप एज अ मुसलमान, ही वॉज़ देयर रोमिंग अराउंड इन सम दरगाह. वो तो एक व्यक्ति ने उनको पकड़ा, पता नहीं लोगों ने सुना होगा ये चीज़, और उसको पकड़ के ले गए अपने कमरे में, पकड़ के इन द सेंस कि आइए मैं आपसे, तो उसने कहा आप हिंदू हो, आप मुसलमान नहीं हो. वही उसने कई चीज़ों से पता, उसने कहा यस, बोलता है मैं भी हिंदू हूँ पर पिछले कितने बीसियों साल से आई एम लिविंग लाइक अ मुसलमान एंड एज चीफ ऑफ अ दरगाह. बट देन इट इज़ अ पासिव रेजिस्टेंस. लेकिन अल्टीमेटली उस सोसाइटी का क्या हुआ, जब तक आप उसको एक्टिवली चेंज नहीं करोगे. पासिव इज़ लाइक आप समय व्यतीत कर रहे हो किसी तरह से. वंस यू गेट योर टाइम, यू हैव टू डू दैट एक्टिवली. That's what I believe.
ये एक प्रॉब्लम है. क्या है कि अ लॉट ऑफ टाइम्स कि हमारा समय ठीक हो जाएगा, ये एक कॉन्सेप्ट है. दिस इज़ नॉट ओनली अ हिंदू कॉन्सेप्ट, दिस इज़ अ कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ अ पर्टिकुलर माइंडसेट. अभी हमारा टाइम ख़राब है, अच्छा समय आएगा, पर हम उस अच्छे समय के लिए हम अपने क्या कर रहे हैं हम इस पर कभी नहीं देखते. हम ये एक तरीके का डिनायल हो जाता है. ये बहुत ही परवेसिव है.
वन ऑफ द क्वेश्चन वॉज कि जूस को कंसंट्रेशन कैंप की तरफ क्यों, मतलब वो सारे चुपचाप क्यों चले गए, उन्होंने कोई जो है रेजिस्टेंस नहीं किया, दे डेंट फाइट मिलिट्रली, दे डेंट इवन रेजिस्ट, राइट. तो जब पैलेस्टाइन दिया गया था जूस को, तो ब्रिटिश ने उनको बताया था कि द जूस आर नॉट द फाइटिंग रेस, दे हैव नेवर फॉट एंड इट विल बी नो टाइम बिफोर यू ओवरकम देम, राइट. तो उनका ये था कि ठीक है, ये मरे हुए जूस सारे दुनिया से जो है आ रहे हैं, इनको ओवरकम करना मुश्किल से कुछ दिनों में हम कर लेंगे. येट when the Jews came to the Palestine, they got their land and they fought like just wounded lions. और वो सारे हैरान हो गए कि ये लोग जो सिर नीचा करके concentration camps में जा रहे थे मरने के लिए, इनमें अचानक इतनी जो है power कहाँ से आ गई, right? They were very puzzled and they, you know, this is one of the biggest, less known talks about it, and this is lesser known talks about it, that why the Jews suddenly turned from being, such docile creatures who could be led to the slaughterhouse to suddenly the best warriors. Today, the Jewish army is one of the best in the world. 12 countries could not destroy them together. Sure, they learned from this. You know where the change, why the change came about? The change came about because the Jew stopped himself thinking as an individual and thought himself as a collective. Ki ab jo hai ye hamara desh hai, hum sabko ek desh mein jo hai ek hoke collective hoke jo hai sochna hai, individually ab nahi sochna hai. To my Jewish friends, they often tell me ki hamare course mein, hamare syllabus mein, hamare thinking mein sab jagah hum ye drill karte hain, you are not an individual, you are a Jew, you are part of a race, and that is something that we also need. We are deeply fragmented inside, we need to change. I mahare ka dhanyawad karna chahta hu that you all came. It was a very stimulating discussion. Let me just share it. And I think that you all, I hope that you really enjoyed it, you liked it. And we brought about a different aspect. We shared many things together. And it has been an honor to listen to everyone and give comments. I learned a lot today in today's meeting. And as someone rightly pointed out, I should include that in my next book. I'll definitely do that. I accept it humbly, right? A writer always learns, and I'm becoming a writer every day as I see things, as I write about different things. So thanks to all of you for coming. Aap sabka bahut bahut dhanyawad.